makes no sound. I'll find vanity in your eyes. You'll always be my night sky.
Thank you. And I've been chillin', watching the ocean with you. Baby, up with a slow motion crew. And we up in our growlings when people change, but not us. And we just chillin', kicking it, kissed by the sun. Could be soaked to the skin in the moss soon. I know she got the good vibes when seasons change, but we're the same. Even if I lost all my money, the zero runs deep, honey. And I don't need to speak a single word.
Aeronautical and Precision Engineering YouTube channel. So before we head off into the guest itself, on behalf of the team, I would like to just present to you a quick update on the developments of the Aquila rocket team, mainly on our Aquila 7 rocket. And so if we could have the other screen.
Yeah,
sure. And so you could see that on the bottom right-hand side of your screen, is a rendition of the Aquila 7 rocket. And just to give yourself a little teaser of what to be expected from the Aquila 7, we are looking for, we're in the process of developing the Aquila 7 rocket, which is a fully composite built rocket, other than the actual engine itself. And so the Aquila 7 rocket will be of a height of around 2.5 meters tall. And that is significantly larger in size compared to the Aquila 6 that was successfully launched in August the 18th, 2020. Cool number. We're looking at a 5 times higher speed or 5 times maximum velocity of in comparison to the Aquila 6 rocket. And we're looking at a maximum apogee of 5 times higher than the Aquila 6 rocket. And also looking at supersonic flight. And so the past few months, the team itself has been expanded. We've brought in a few first years to make the family a little bit bigger. And so we have been looking into because we are going to more supersonic flight, that means the aerodynamics of the fins and also the rocket itself, especially the nose cone, has to be engineered in a way so that it can actually withstand the supersonic forces. And so the past few months have just been mostly us researching, testing, and actually looking at in terms of how the aerodynamics integrity of the rocket can withstand the supersonic loads or supersonic speed and induced loads onto the rocket itself. And with the current measures happening in mind, we do have a lack in progression, but that is nothing that we can do for now. So the team itself is mostly just working online and having regular meetings to make sure that we do have some progression so that when the time comes that we can actually work in the compo lab that we're currently in, that we'd have things going on. And without further ado, I would like to give off to Mr. Eric Van, who will be doing the guest lecture. Q&A sessions are allowed throughout, so just make sure to send them in the chat sections. And other than that, I'm just going to let it off to you then.
Hoor je me nu? Okay. Sorry for that. The mic was off. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this lecture. I'm going to take you on a tour through time and space, and start in a far history where spaceflight happened. First, a little bit about myself. I'm a so-called hybrid teacher in Holland, aeronautical and precision engineering. I'm part-time teacher, lecturing precision engineering subjects and also space engineering. And the other part of my time, I have my own company. It's called Ion Orbit, and I do some consultancy for the space industry. You see myself here on the picture working on the ozone monitoring instrument, which is now happily measuring the quality of our atmosphere from space. This is the thing I do next to working also in Holland. But tonight it's totally different. We're going to take a tour, as I said, through time and space. And you can start at any point, of course. But I like to start here with Tintin, Kuifje, as we call him in Dutch, who was the first who landed on the moon back in 1953. Together with his friends, and this is where you see him welcoming Neil Armstrong in 1969. Hergé, the comic writer, had some very interesting thoughts about society, but also about space, and he had some very advanced thoughts also how this would happen. Think about it, it's 1953, and nothing has happened yet really in space, and he already envisioned how it would be to go to the moon. Of course, we could go even a little bit further back in time. 1865, Jules Verne, he wrote a book, From the Earth to the Moon, and he also had some very interesting thoughts about how to go to the moon and come back again. But let's now start at a real start point for space, as I see it. And that's, of course, when the Soviet Union, in 1957, on the 4th of October, they launched their first satellite, their artificial object. Satellite that was about 84 kilos, so quite a big ball with some antennas. And it was in space for a total of 3 months, of which there was 1 month real operation of the satellite, real working satellite. It had a very low perigee of only 215 kilometers. So after 3 months, the atmosphere caused this satellite to deorbit. But this was a big moment for the world, and especially for the United States, as we will see later. And they were really triggered by this launch of Sputnik, because it showed to them that the intercontinental ballistic missile that the Soviet Union was building, they could actually launch something into space, which also meant they could launch nuclear weapons to the United States. So they were really triggered and tried to catch on with the Soviet Union. But they had quite a tough time doing that, to catch on with the Soviet Union, because Sputnik, as we see it here, it followed quickly with Sputnik 2 and Sputnik 3 and other satellites that the Soviet Union launched, and they were very advanced with respect to the US. And even in 1961, they showed that they put the first man in space. And we see Yuri Gagarin on the 12th of April 1961. He launched into space. He had one orbit only and landed back in the Soviet Union. He basically ejected himself at 7 kilometers altitude from the capsule. So he landed by parachute. And he was only 1.57 meters, eh? And that's not really tall, but yeah, this whole capsule where Yuri Gagarin was in was of course a small capsule, and they had to find one of the smallest people that could do it, and was able to do it there, because it was a hazardous adventure. The risks that this mission would go wrong were high, and nobody knew that this was happening outside of a little group. Only when it became a success, they had to teach the world that the Soviet Union again beat the rest of the world in space. So this really triggered the United States. They put a lot of money in their program to beat the Soviet Union in space, because they had this Cold War going on after the Second World War. There was a big fight between the Soviet Union and the United States, the capitalists and against the communists, and who would rule the world. And this basically went not into real war, but it went into Cold War. And this was the space race that was really the epitome of this whole quarrel between the Soviet Union and the United States. And the United States, they put a lot of money in it, and they started doing things. The famous JFK speech back in 1962, where he said, before the end of this decade, we'll put a man on the moon. And actually, they did it in 1969. The 21st of July, they put Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong on the surface of the moon. And actually, this whole Apollo program, it was actually also really a result from the Cold War, because the big mastermind of this Apollo program and the huge Saturn V that was developed for especially for going to the moon, Wernher von Braun was the big mastermind there who thought about everything. And already back in 1953, so around the time when Hergé wrote the Tintin comic books, also Wernher von Braun really developed his ideas of going to the moon. And this looks all very very nice, of course, but there is also a little bit of a dark side to this person, Wernher von Braun. He was the mastermind for peaceful purposes going to the moon, but he was actually captured during the World War II in Germany, as he was a German rocket scientist. He was captured by the United States and brought to the United States, especially to advance the missile capabilities of the United States. And actually, Wernher von Braun, he was also the mastermind behind the so-called V2 rocket. And the V2 rocket was the rocket of Adolf Hitler, the Nazi regime. And he sent many of those V2 rockets onto London, and many people were killed actually because of this rocket. But not only in London, actually a short distance from where I stand here in Delft, the Netherlands, in the dunes of The Hague, close to Wassenaar, you will find the places where these V2 rockets actually launched. And they also killed people there, because those rockets also sometimes exploded on the launch pad. But this is a dark side of the big mastermind of the Apollo. There's another curious story about this Apollo. He was in Apollo 13. Should I continue? We're losing sound, or?
even los van mijn microfoon even.
Oké. Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. Ja? Zijn we weer live? Ja, we zijn sowieso live. Okay, so the mic's on again. Sorry for the interruption. So we were with our friend Fred Hayes. And as you can see, Fred Hayes is an astronaut, and he was actually the backup pilot for the Apollo 11. So, but as Buzz Aldrin, who was the real pilot on board Apollo 11, he actually flew. He stayed on the ground, but he was put on Apollo 13, the well-known mission that went wrong, actually horribly. But Fred Hayes was also a pilot on Apollo 13, but he never made it on the moon, as Apollo 13 got a mishap during the way on the way to the moon, and they had to come back. But during this mission, Fred also got this kidney failure, and he got a kidney disease. So he really had a lousy time on board Apollo 13. They barely made it alive, all the three astronauts, and also Fred. He had he was much in much pain because of his kidney. So he was later put on a flight called Apollo 19. But of course we know that only six Apollo missions flew, Apollo 11 to Apollo 17. And six of them only landed on the moon, and he was put on Apollo 19. And yeah, actually, all the missions after Apollo 17, so Apollo 18, 19, and 20, they were actually planned to fly to the moon, but they were cancelled because of the money. These were expensive missions that went to the moon, and they had to cancel it because all the public, they didn't really watch it on television anymore. They were not interested because they've seen it now six times, and they got a bit fed up. So here we see one of the Saturn V rockets, which was never used. So this might be the Apollo 18, and actually Apollo 19 could be in Kennedy Space Center. The real story is that these rockets are built from all kinds of spare materials that were used in the development of Apollo 18, 19, and 20. So only two rockets were put together from all these materials, and you can still see them, and they're really huge rockets. And actually also there was a movie made about Apollo 18, and it's really, I would recommend it if you like some horror movie, because strange things happen on the moon on during this Apollo 18 mission. So I would recommend Aquilo to hold the movie night and screen this Apollo 18 movie. Some time went by, Apollo was cancelled, and the United States was going to look for how to go to space again. And they invented basically the space shuttle. And this was a, from my perspective, a successful program. They flew 135 times to space and also back, because the unique thing of the space shuttle was that it could return back to space and fly again. And of course, this also created some problems. They had two mishaps where they lost the crew. So two out of these 135 missions, they lost some astronauts during operations. And this was a bit due to the design of this space shuttle, because it had to do so many things. It had to be good for going into space, keeping astronauts alive for almost 3 weeks. It also had to be able to carry big satellites for the NRO, the National Reconnaissance Office, so all these secret spy satellites. The space shuttle should be able to put them on board, and this basically stretched the design of the space shuttle, and to a level that it became less safe. And they found it out, of course, after these mishaps, that these choices were not always well taken. So looking back at 135 missions, it became a very costly exercise. Per mission, it would almost cost $500 million to fly this space shuttle into space and do all kinds of things. And so it was an expensive one, but there were also many successes, of course. It put the International Space Station into space for the largest part, was built by the space shuttle. And what did the Russians do all the time? So they were active with Yuri Gagarin. They had the first spacewalk. And they had the first woman in space, but then they were beat by the US with going to the moon. But quickly the Soviet Union took their chances in building space stations. And so already in 1972, they put already Salyut 1 into orbit, the first space station. And they brought astronauts there that stayed for a few months and were taken back again. And so they built lots of these space stations over the years. And I think the most famous one is Salyut 7, because at some point it was abandoned because of things that went wrong. And there was a crew that went up to this Salyut 7 and basically rescued the Salyut 7 again. And there's a beautiful movie made of this mission, how they saved the Salyut 7 mission. I would say this is the Apollo 13 of the Soviet Union. It all culminated for the Soviet Union to build the Mir space station. 1986 is the first module put in space of the Mir space station. And it went all the way to 2001 that they had astronauts on board. They had space shuttles visiting. So the Soviet Union really knew how to build space stations. And actually, this Mir space station, at some point, it was actually more or less sold to a company called Mircorp. And the funny thing is, Mircorp had its headquarters in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. That's a fact that not many people know. And they had the headquarters here because of all kinds of tax reasons. But they were actually the first company that hired a astronaut crew to go to the Mir space station, which was abandoned back in 1999, and had them go up there and get Mir space station up and running again. And we see here the first real commercial astronauts, Sergei Salyutin, Alexander Kalary, being the first paid for astronauts by a commercial company to go into space, and paid for by Mircorp, which was actually based in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. Everything didn't go well for this whole operation. In the end, the Mir space station was deorbited under pressure from NASA, who was building the International Space Station, and said this Mir space station is just in the way of successful cooperation between Russia, because the Soviet Union didn't exist anymore, the cooperation between Russia and the United States. So this Mir space station has to be deorbited, and we continue with the International Space Station. So this was also the end of Mircorp, unfortunately. And so also the Soviet Union, after they put the Mir space station into orbit, they also did some interesting things in space. This is 1987, where on top of a, attached to a big booster, the Energia
booster, they Polius spacecraft, this black arrow, and it looks like a rocket, but it's actually a huge laser. It's a 1 megawatt CO2 laser, and it was a prototype for a weapon that could be used from space. Remember, this was 1987. This was the high times of the Cold War. Reagan was developing SDI. All kinds of things were happening, and this launch with this weapon happened in 1987. And actually, Gorbachev, the leader of the Soviet Union, was against launching this thing, but the generals actually pushed it through. So it was launched, but fortunately for world peace, I would say, the launch was not a success, because at some point the Polius space weapon had to detach from the Energia booster and rotate 180 degrees and fire an engine to reach the correct orbit. But there was some error made in the software, and they didn't rotate 180 degrees, they rotated 360 degrees. They ignited the engine, and this weapon was destroyed, luckily, in the atmosphere of the Earth. But what could happen if this was a success? The Soviet Union would have this weapon in space, where basically with a laser, they could zap from space anything that would be in their path. So this was a dangerous thing for world peace, and luckily this did not succeed. A second launch on top of this Energia booster, which was by then the biggest and strongest rocket in the world, was the space shuttle Buran. Here we see the Buran attached to the Energia rocket. They launched this this Buran, and it flew I believe two orbits, and then it landed again back in the Soviet Union, and it landed automatically, so there was no astronauts on board, and they had a very successful flight. And I would say, compared to the space shuttle, because it looks a lot like the space shuttle, people would say they copied the United States space shuttle. Actually, lots of things were different for this one, and it was I believe a safer space shuttle, and also a more capable space shuttle, because it could take 20,000 kilos from space to Earth, where the space shuttle could take 15,000 kilos from space to Earth. And so it was a much more capable built thing. Unfortunately, it only flew once, because the Soviet Union collapsed somewhere around 1989, and this space shuttle was put in a hangar in Baikonur. And I believe about 10 years later, this hangar got destroyed because too much snow was on the roof. And this thing is somewhere under this building. Unfortunately, this masterpiece of Soviet Union engineering, I would say, is no longer with us, unfortunately. So back to this International Space Station, that really emerged from the Mir space station, I would say. Lots of Russian technology has gone into the design of the International Space Station. It's now a cooperation project between many nations in the world: Japan, Europe, United States, Russia, and it's there since 1998, and it's been very successful. And actually, the first private citizen astronaut that went into space was Dennis Tito. He paid for himself. He paid $20 million. For an 8-day trip, so $2.5 million a day. Imagine that holiday, spending that amount per day on your holiday. But he did that. He spent 8 days in the International Space Station, and he was the first private citizen in space. And many people believe this is the start of commercial space, but this is only the start of a private citizen paying for himself to go into space. Because commercial space, I would say, started already in the 1980s. And many people believe that commercial space only started with Elon Musk launching Falcon rockets. No, the real commercial space already started in the 80s, where telecom operators would pay for a launch to put a satellite into geostationary orbit to do satellite telecommunication. And by now there is about 550 of these geostationary satellites are in orbit at an altitude of 36,000 kilometers. Because at 36,000 kilometers, you have an orbit time of 24 hours, so the satellite stays exactly above the same point all the time. And there's now 550 of these satellites in space, and this is basically the real commercial space, if you would ask me. Because another thing that people think is that this started commercial space. When Richard Branson, he basically bought himself into Spaceship One back in 2004, this Spaceship One won a prize to go to suborbital space to an altitude of 100 kilometers two times within 2 weeks, and it won a prize of, I believe, $10 million. And this would basically be the first commercial entity that would go into space. And Richard Branson stepped on there, and he is now trying to scale this up towards Spaceship Two, and still trying to reach space, what he calls, but I would call it suborbital space. There's another guy around, another billionaire. His name is Jeff Bezos. He's known, of course, for as the owner of Amazon, the big store. And yearly he puts about $1 billion of his own money into Blue Origin. And he developed this rocket, the New Shepard. And this New Shepard also goes to suborbital space. So it goes to an altitude of about 100, 110 kilometers. And it has some time weightlessness. So about 4 or 5 minutes, you'll be weightless. And you can do all kinds of microgravity experiments. And there are many agencies in the world use these services and do experiments there. But the ultimate goal is to put people on there that could have a nice view of the Earth while being weightless at an altitude of about 100 kilometers. But I would like to make the distinction, of course, between suborbital and orbital. Because both these companies are selling this as going into space, where I would say it's not really space, because, well, they reach the altitude of space, which is about 100 kilometers, and this is basically some arbitrary number. We could argue long about what is the real number where you go into space, but 100 kilometers is a value that basically everybody uses. So if you go over that value, you are in space. But if you then fall back, you're not in space anymore. And so there is the difference between suborbital space and orbital space. Well, suborbital space, you can reach 100 kilometers if you have a rocket that ultimately goes 1 kilometer per second, and at some point you coast towards this altitude. But if you want to go orbital with a rocket, you need about 8 times more velocity, because you have to fall over the horizon and you have to orbit the Earth, actually. You have to go a lot faster. So 8 kilometers per second. And we all know that the kinetic energy goes with the square of the velocity. So you would need 64 times more energy to go into space compared to suborbital space. So these Blue Origin and Virgin Galactic, they are not going to orbital space. Who is going to orbital space is this capsule. This is the Dragon capsule built by SpaceX, a company from Elon Musk, well known also as the CEO of Tesla. And he has developed this capsule in a contract for NASA. And so again, this is, they call it commercial space, but in the end, this capsule, of course, is paid for by the US taxpayer. So I would not completely call it commercial, because it's paid by tax dollars from US citizens. But still, Elon Musk is quite successful, as we know. And he put, like, the first two commercial astronauts in space. But I would say not really commercial. These are, of course, NASA astronauts. They're on the payroll of NASA, so they're not private citizens. They are NASA employees. So they're not like Dennis Tito. They're not paying their fare by themselves. But now it is an operator that is commercial. SpaceX fully services NASA to put the NASA astronauts into space. And so there is a new dimension here, that there is a private company with their own rocket, and it's not a NASA rocket, it's the rocket of SpaceX, and they sell the service to NASA that they will put astronauts in space. And they were quite successful. They've put now for the second time astronauts on the ISS, and the second crew is currently in the ISS, and we'll be back again soon with the Dragon capsule. Now to this gentleman, President Trump. This is President Trump in 2017, where I think one of the few things he did well was a space policy directive to say that the US should go beyond low Earth orbit and go to the moon and go to Mars. In some way what other presidents had already said. Each president kind of repeats that the US should go beyond low Earth orbit. So President Trump did that as well. But please have a look at how Buzz Aldrin, the second man on the moon, he's on the right of Donald Trump. He looks a bit confused, and you should really watch the YouTube video, because he's quite some mimic in his face on what President Trump is all saying there, because it doesn't really all make sense what he says, as we can repeatedly see on television. But this happened 2017. Go back to the moon, and NASA took that as a directive. They developed the Artemis program and said, okay, let's go to Mars, but first step is to go to the moon, and let's develop these Artemis missions and land the first man on the moon and the next man and the first woman on the moon. One of the foundations for this Artemis project is this rocket, the SLS rocket. And we see a number of versions on the screen for this rocket. So on the left we see SLS Block 1, and that's basically the rocket that's being developed now, being tested now, because in about a year they plan to have their first launch with this rocket. And this is basically like, again, a Saturn V class rocket, the same size, almost the same capability, that will launch apparently next year. But this development of this rocket already started in 2005. It was called then Ares-5 in the Constellation program, which was cancelled by, or which was started by George Bush, cancelled by Barack Obama. But this Ares-5 rocket lingered on and became the SLS rocket, and is still under development. It had already a cost of $20 billion, this rocket, and it is still on the ground, and hopefully we will see it launch next year. And there is a number of versions there. In the end, there is the SLS Block 2 cargo. And the big difference there is that the side boosters are newly developed. And there is an exploration upper stage, which is very capable. So this is will really put a lot of weight into space. But this rocket is really beyond the horizon. This is like planned for the 2030s and further away. So this is very far in the future. So this is the rocket as we will see hopefully next year on the pad. It has two side boosters, and they look very similar to the side booster that the space shuttle also had. And that's no coincidence, because they are built by the same manufacturer, only they are made a bit taller. So the space shuttle has three segments, and these boosters has five segments. And there is another thing which is very similar to the space shuttle, and that those are the engines of the core stage. We see here in the facility where they built the rocket, we see these four RS-25 engines. And they look like the space shuttle engines. And in fact, they are the space shuttle engines. They are reused from the space shuttle program. But we have to, of course, understand that these space shuttle engines are very expensive, because the space shuttle was launched and went back from space on Earth and be launched again. So these engines needed to be very, very good to survive the re-entry and to be used many times over. But now for SLS, they're using four of these engines, and they will use them only once, because this rocket will basically be destroyed after use. And so these missions with SLS will become very expensive. Yes?
Why are all those rich people and governments spending the amount of money to go to space?
You mean, okay, why are the rich people like Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos, Richard Branson, why are they spending that money in space? Well, I think it's partly the part of the reason is that you see that government spending in space has climbed. And those billionaires, they see a market that governments are interested more in space than they used to be. So they see a business with a big customer, the United States. For example, SpaceX, people look at SpaceX as being a commercial company, which well, they are, they operate commercially. But if you look at this year's number of launches, they launched about 27 times their Falcon 9 rocket, but only 3 of them were real commercial missions, so paid for by companies for telecommunication. The other missions were either paid for by NASA or paid for by the DoD with spy satellites, or their own Starlink program. Basically their own money and putting that in space. So they see the United States government as a big customer where you can make a lot of money from. But yeah, apart from that, they also see that there is a need for internet connectivity in the world. So Starlink by SpaceX, that's a big business model that they foresee. And also Jeff Bezos with Blue Origin. He's also working on a project called Project Kuiper, which basically also wants to put a constellation of telecom satellites in low Earth orbit and basically provide internet services to the world and make sure that everybody goes to their internet through them and go to Amazon and buy stuff. That's their thinking. Yeah, we'll get there later, but this is certainly of interest. Only the horizon for that is very long. And so that's not a business that you say, let's start it now, and in 5 years we'll see return on investment, because that will be 50 years in time. But yeah, there's companies out there that do that. But yeah. Yeah, that's a good question. I totally agree with that, because I think the SLS rocket, I believe it's a waste of money. I think we will see that rocket launch next year, but probably it will get delayed by a year, because that happens all the time with SLS. And it will fly once. And actually, the plan is on the second launch of SLS, they want to put astronauts on board and send it around the moon. And I'm not convinced that in the end NASA will really say, okay, let's put people on there on the second launch of this completely new rocket. But yeah, there is a lot of politics going on there with SLS. There's a number of senators that are really lobbying very hard for this rocket, because there is voters in districts that support those senators that want him to keep in office, because they support their work, because this is a big project. What I said, $20 billion has been spent already in this rocket, so that's a lot of wages for people. Yes, at this moment, yes. So there's Falcon Heavy. So there was the point that the SLS will have a bigger payload capability, and that is what you need to go. If you really want to do exploration missions, you need a high payload capability. Because in the meantime, there is the Falcon Heavy, which is coming closer to that payload capability. And of course, we are seeing the developments by SpaceX for this Starship, which will have even a higher capability than SLS. But the big question is, will that be in the end successful or not? And I would put my money on Elon Musk for for being successful. Okay, let's continue.
Yes.
Yeah, so on top of this SLS, what is currently being put together is this Orion vehicle. And the Orion vehicle is a capsule which carries astronauts and will be carrying astronauts to the moon. And this is a big capsule, bigger than the Dragon capsule from SpaceX, because the SLS rocket has a bigger capability. And this Orion capsule actually has some Dutch flavor on it, because the solar panels of this Orion capsule are built by Airbus Defence and Space in the Netherlands, in Leiden. So you see here the facility in Leiden, or actually this is not in Leiden, but you see the solar panels being put on the Orion. This is a bit of a Dutch flavor in the space exploration business. What I also like to show you is that this program has been going on very long already. So this is from 2014. You see a Delta IV Heavy, one of the heavy launchers of the United States. And on top of is the first Orion capsule that was tested in 2014. It sent up this Orion capsule, I believe, to about 7,000 kilometers or 6,000 kilometers. And it then fall back to the Earth to demonstrate that this Orion could do the re-entry, could survive the re-entry. And it did. It landed after 4.5 hours of flight. It landed in the ocean, and they caught it again, and they learned a lot from this launch. But this is already 6 years ago. And then Artemis, what's coming in the future? So Artemis 1 will be this first launch of SLS, probably next year, or say hopefully next year, probably not, but hopefully next year, that will be Artemis 1. Artemis 2 will be the first crewed flight, which I think is not going to happen, but it's still on the picture. They will put astronauts on board and will fly around the moon. And then Artemis 3, finally, they will put astronauts on the moon. So on the third flight of SLS, they will put astronauts on the moon. And the plan is 2024. And I think that's a completely ridiculous idea to be able to put astronauts on the moon already in 2024. Because if you see what can go wrong in this picture, I would more be inclined to say this will happen, if everything goes well, in 2028 maybe. I still say maybe, because that's 24 is just way too close. I think this was just a push from the Trump administration to show that after a potential second term, they could have a show off. Look, we are putting people on the moon, which is it's completely unrealistic, I would say. And here is some more mission profile of the Artemis 3 mission. One of the interesting ingredients, which is a bit unsure if it is still part of Artemis 3, is the so-called Gateway. And that's a space station in orbit around the moon. And so the original idea was also to have this space station in orbit around the moon by 2024, which by itself I think is also not feasible to aim for. Because all this hardware needs to be built, needs to be tested, needs to be launched, things go wrong. Before this space station is in an orbit around the moon, this will take many years, and certainly not before 2024. And the interesting thing is that the Gateway has a role in putting astronauts on the moon, being able to communicate with the astronauts on the moon, because the plan is that the astronauts go to the South Pole of the moon. Because all the Apollo missions and the Russians or the Soviet Union, when they went to the moon, they all went more or less to the equator. And people believe, scientists believe, that on the poles of the moon, some very interesting science can be done. So they want to send astronauts there, but they need a way to communicate with them. And you need this space station high above the South Pole to be able to communicate to the Earth through this Gateway. One of the important reasons that they want this Gateway. But I believe at the moment it's a bit in a shaky situation where it is not really part of Artemis 3 anymore. Going back to... Wait, I would like to show you something. We see on the right here that this Orion capsule is docked to the gateway. And we see the beautiful solar panels of Airbus Defence and Space Netherlands as the Dutch contribution to this exploration effort that we see here circling around the moon. But I would like to show you also that the Dutch don't really put so much money into space. This is the a bit of a dull page to read, but it shows how much money all the European nations put into space. Because all the European nations, they work together in the European Space Agency. And we can find that the Netherlands only has 2.4% of this total. And if you look at how much money the GDP is in the Netherlands, we should have like almost 5% of this contribution. So the Netherlands is always a bit laid back, to my frustration, I must say, because a lot of developments always are taking place somewhere else because the Netherlands has too little contribution in the space domain. And I would like to increase that and improve that, but of course, we need the Dutch government to be aware that they are really a backbencher in the European Space Agency. Because this person by himself puts five times more money into space than the Netherlands. So this is one person in the US. That's incredible. And so here's this Jeff Bezos, the founder and the CEO of Amazon and also of Blue Origin. He's part of also of this moon program. He wants to build the lander that puts humans on the moon surface. And here you see him presenting his moon lander. And of course, we have Elon Musk. When he was a little bit younger, I actually met him back in 2004 at a conference. And he was, I must say, still laughed at a bit whenever people were behind his back saying, oh, look, he is a rich guy. He won't make it in space. He will be he will be a billionaire, but he will be a millionaire because he wants to go in space. But actually, he showed that he was the other way around. And so it's very impressive to see what he did in space. And what he did was, he started with Falcon 1, the first rocket that they developed, and they launched it a few times. Things went horribly wrong, and really the last launch that really succeeded put them over the edge of almost being bankrupt. But at some point they abandoned the Falcon 1 because they didn't really believe that the microsatellite ecosystem would really rise up, and they started Falcon 9 with a bigger capability. And we all know that Falcon 9 is now more than 100 launches performed, a very successful launcher, and it's also the first that is reusable, so they can reuse the first stage that impressively lands on a barge in the Atlantic. And they have also got a beefed up version of the Falcon 9. It's called the Falcon Heavy. It's basically three Falcon 9s glued together. We all know that he had a very interesting test flight, putting his own Tesla Roadster around the sun, which is still floating somewhere in an orbit around the sun at a distance similar to Mars around the sun. And he showed that his Falcon Heavy was very capable and very successful. And of course, we know that he is developing an even bigger rocket. And back in 2017, he gave his first presentation at the IAC, which is the conference for all the space nerds like me. He gave a presentation on the big Falcon rocket. He called it the BFR. And this is what it looked like back then. And this is what it looks like now. So there's lots of changes. It's grown a little bit bigger compared to the previous version. And it is now the biggest rocket in development. If you compare it to the new Glenn rocket by Blue Origin, the Saturn V, and of course all the SLS options, it is now the biggest rocket around. And the impressive thing is that in 3 years, and not like SLS, that they started in 2005 with RS5 development, 15 years later, we have not seen any hardware fly of this SLS. But here we see 3 years of time, they announced this big Falcon rocket, and now 3 years later, we have already seen many explosions, but also many successful launches. And we've seen the last of these last week with the SN8 launch, which was very successful. It launched to an altitude of about 15 kilometers. It did some very interesting maneuver at that altitude. It basically started to float back down on its belly. So it did a so-called belly flop, what they called it. And then just before it tried to land, it did this inverse belly flop. But unfortunately, there was some engine problem. It basically crashed. But all in all, this was a very successful test. They demonstrated a lot of capabilities for this rocket. And Elon Musk said, this landing will be fixed with the next one, SN9, Starship SN9, which is already almost on the launch pad. So they're really successfully doing real hardware tests. And that's the big difference between the approach of SpaceX to NASA, where NASA takes long theoretical processes and much paperwork, where SpaceX just tries out things and just have things explode. We have to understand they're also in a different world. NASA is from the government. So if the government would do all kinds of wild testing and things exploding, the taxpayer would say, well, what are you doing with my money? But Elon Musk is spending his own money. He basically can do what he wants. But it shows to me that the development goes faster in this way. In the end, this is the idea, of course, of the Starship, where we see a total stack of about 120 meters. So on top is the 50-meter Starship. So the SN8 is a bit of the is on top there, and there is a big booster underneath of 70 meters, making a total stack of 120 meters. And the impressive thing is that they plan to make this fully reusable. So all the things that you will see of the Starship, they can reuse again. At least that is the plan, and that's also the big challenge that they will need to show. And that's still a big unknown if that will really happen. There is also already a first customer for this mission. That's a Japanese businessman, Maezawa, Yusaka Maezawa is his name. He has a lot of money and he poured that into SpaceX, and he wants to become the first customer to fly to the moon. And he put up a website, he called Dear Moon is his mission, and he wants to go to orbit around the moon with a number of painters, musicians, a film director, fashion designer, and he's accumulating this group to really go into space. And his plan is to go there at the point, the moment that the Starship is ready. And Elon Musk says this will be ready at 2023, 2024. And this is the flight plan. And remarkably, this looks a lot like the Artemis II mission that I've shown you as part of the Artemis program. So what will happen in the after that? We go to the moon. We might build lunar villages. We might harvest even helium-3 on the moon, which could be used in the very future nuclear fusion reactors. But these are all very far in the future, I would say beyond 50 to 100 years in the future. And of course, we have set our sights to the planet Mars. And we see here one of the Martian astronauts you might recognize from the movie The Martian. You should really see that movie, who has all kinds of problems on the surface of Mars and makes it back in the... Oh, sorry, I shouldn't have said that. Mars has always been in the imagination of our, the Earthlings. And this is a picture from 1977 of the Viking orbiter. And we see an interesting feature on the surface then we recognize this phase. The phase on Mars, this was called, and many people believe back then, 1977, this showed that there was humans or people or aliens out there that built this feature. But 20 years later, there was a new orbiter and showed that it was just a big rock. So no aliens building this. But I must admit that there were all kinds of people that thought, okay, before they took this picture, the U.S. bombed this face to make sure that nobody knew that the Martians were there. In the future, this could be the future for us Earthlings to go to Mars with your entire family and to walk around. Yeah, but Mars is not really a very comfortable place. It is very cold, it's dusty. There is almost no air, so surviving is hard there. And then, of course, asteroid mining, that's also a promise in the future, that you go to asteroids and you mine them and use that material in space. And I believe this is really a key enabler of space exploration, that you're using all the materials and not having the need to bring that up from the Earth's surface. So this will be a good future, only the future is a bit far in the future, so I would say 50 years from now, this will take place. So all kinds of businesses started here, and one of them is Deep Space Industries, and there was another one, Planetary Resources. Planetary Resources went bankrupt, and Deep Space Industries is kind of on doing this in a niche way. And so there is no real business model short term for asteroid mining. And the other thing people are looking at is space elevators. Had to build basically a skyscraper from the surface, and you could take the elevator and go all the way up to space. But if you look at all the materials that you need to build such a thing, I would say this is quite impossible on Earth. But this might be a future for the moon, that you build such an elevator on the moon, to be able to just take the stairs and go to space from the moon surface up. Yet another thing is space-based solar power, and that would mean that you have huge solar panels, of course built from asteroid materials, huge solar panels, and you collect solar energy and you beam that back to Earth, and basically solving the energy crisis on Earth. And this can all be done, it's all already shown experimentally that it can be done. It only needs to be scaled up massively. And then we go to the final. I want to talk about this lady, Mae Jemison. She's an astronaut, 1992 Space Shuttle Endeavour, very accomplished, and she started a project called the 100-Year Starship back in 2013. There's a nice website for that. And what she envisions is that we shall build a starship and go to the next planet, not in our own solar system, but near another star. And so the project to build this spaceship has already started. This is basically the first template they're looking at, but you engineers already know this is not a successful spacecraft. If you would ignite this engine here, you understand that the center of mass, there would be some moment of inertia, and this would go tumbling. Lousy design, I would say. Not start with this. So the final thing in 2113 will look quite differently from this. There will be some point that humans will leave forever planet Earth, either to go to Mars, stay there forever, or just leave the entire solar system and go to another planet near another star. And we will look back to Earth and we will understand what Earth is bringing us. There is air to breathe, there is water to drink, there is lots of things that we can be very happy with about Earth, and that some politicians should also made more aware that there is only one planet and we have to take very good care for that. I think the space program always makes it happen. This is a drawing by Edgar Mitchell, which was the Apollo 14 astronaut. He walked on the moon and he painted this because he really felt it. He saw the Earth from the moon with his own eyes. It must be incredible, I think, to see that. And he kind of, it dawned upon him that There is only one Earth, and yeah, he said, look at that, you son of a bitch. We have only one. With that, I would like to conclude. Thank you.
Yep.
Done. Switch around.
Switch around?
Yep, switch around. Switcheroo, the click. 1, 2, switcheroo. Thank you. Which way? Alright, let me take off my mask then. Gotta keep it corona proof.
Hello, test us?
Yes.
Yeah. Alright, well, that is the presentation by Mr. Eric Lan. Going all the way from spawning all the way to a starship, going to the whole development of it, and a lot of interesting points. The chat section has just gone blazing with information. We also have some questions, really good questions as well, and likewise, really good answers from yourself. And I think we thoroughly enjoyed ourselves, both Eric and I. We enjoyed being on this side, and we hope that you, the viewers themselves, have enjoyed themselves on the other side of the camera. And that their evening is well spent. The first day of lockdown, you could say that. So, not to bring it up again. I think, as a whole, to summarize it up, we thank you for joining us and spending and allowing 1 hour of your time to enjoy this presentation by Mr. Eric Lan, and that we somehow have made you interested in whole space race and also the developments in space. And that on behalf of the InHolland Composites, InHolland itself, and as well as SIPCA and your host, Akilo, on behalf of those parties, I would like to wish you and your family a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And remember, we launch it. All right, thanks.
Bye.
I guess I'll swim back in then.
Alright. Questions for Eric?
I reckon.
Yeah, it should be, right? I'm just here hosting it.
I'm not sure how good you are at YouTube, but.
Okay, wait. Let me just slide up again, my butt.
Yeah. Cool. So, sorry about that. We totally overlooked the whole Q&A session, but we do have time for it. I'll be looking at the chat and relaying that back to Eric. And so, let's look at the questions if there are any. Quick. Type. So, we're not looking at any questions yet. If you have one.
Yeah. Well.
So Bob asked, is that a question?
Maybe. So there's an initiative some time ago sending a swarm of small.
Okay, I'm sorry. There's an initiative some time ago sending a swarm of small spacecraft to Proxima Centauri B. Is that still ongoing?
Yes, what is called, I don't remember the name, but it's Pete Warden, a former NASA Ames director. He's behind that project, and that's still going on. And what they basically want to do is make a very lightweight spacecraft and with a big solar sail, and they want to, with a big laser, they want to accelerate these little spacecraft, and to a very high velocity that within like a few tens of years you could reach the first star. So that's certainly still a mission that's going on. But yeah, still you need lots of technology development for that, and that that takes time.
Hello? Yeah?
Right. Let me see, get my iPad. Yeah. Alright, so what are your thoughts on the Kessler syndrome? What are your thoughts on the Kessler syndrome?
My thoughts on the Kessler syndrome. Yeah, the Kessler syndrome is the effect that at some point there is so much stuff in orbit that collisions take place, and over time there is, because of the fragments caused by the collisions, even more collisions take place, and this become like a runaway effect. And we are very far from that point in time that this will happen. But I do think we have to be extremely careful with this, because when it happens, it is unstoppable. And so there's some initiatives going on already to remove orbital debris from space, but that's really, really difficult. Those satellites, they go, and those fragments go with 8 kilometers per second. And yeah, you can sometimes happen, it sometimes happens that satellites are on a collision course with a relative speed of 16 kilometers per second. And so these are enormous velocities, and before you can remove all the objects, and you need a lot of missions to go there and clean that all up. And so it's important that any mission that goes into space now should be able to deorbit itself. And for example, on optical Earth observation missions, there is many times a lens cap, and those lens caps used to be just jettisoned into space, and they became their own satellite, and yeah, they could hit something. But there is now new regulations that such things, you have to keep your lens caps, you're not allowed to throw something overboard anymore. But they should have done that much earlier. And there is also Starlink, the mission by Elon Musk. He filed for, in total, I believe, 42,000 satellites to be launched in low Earth orbit. And I think that's just too much. That would be, it's not close to the Kessler syndrome from happening, but if we also have Jeff Bezos do the same, and we have another billionaire doing the same, there will be so many objects in space that it becomes really risky to go there and put your satellite there, and makes it unusable. So it's something really to be very careful about.
All right, and there is another question from, I think it was from Arnold earlier. So it's about the countries spending on space programs. If the Netherlands had enough money for space investments, what position should we take in the global developments that are taking place?
So if the Netherlands would not have like 2.4%, but like double, or triple, why not? Now they could do so much more. I'm working with a lot of space companies which are really constrained by that fact that the Netherlands doesn't have such a big contribution. And you see what happens in the European Space Agency context. There is a project, and there's money flowing from all the states into ESA, and ESA has to spend that in those states relative to the contribution of the country. So it could well be that at some point you develop something for ESA for a certain mission, but then it happens that the Netherlands doesn't put enough money into ESA, and then ESA will say, well, you did a nice development, but we'll be going with Portuguese company who will start the development all from start, because the Portuguese government puts more money into ESA. So you could have much more, only with double size you could do so much more. You could not even do double more, but you could triple more, because everything you do for ESA, there is also the commercial market, and so there is a multiplier there. So if you do double for ESA, you would really triple for the commercial world.
Right, and then there's another question about ESA as well. Why doesn't ESA launch their own rockets with astronauts in them?
Yeah, that goes back a long time. That goes back to the 80s, where this decision was taken, particularly by France, who took that position saying, we don't want to launch astronauts. We want to be more practical in our approach to space, because putting humans in space that Europeans are more pragmatic to that point. They are more reserved to putting astronauts in space than the United States. So that's like a basic fact, basically, in politicians that say, yeah, we want to spend things on Earth observation, satellite telecommunication, or Galileo. That they find that much more important than putting astronauts in space.
Kamran has a question regarding the Soyuz capsule. Why Russians can reach ISS in 3 hours and Americans can take up a day?
Yes, that's basically correct. I think for the last two Dragon missions, they took a day. But there is no real reason that they couldn't do that. It's just when you go to the ISS, you could do the direct route. But you have no time to do all kinds of testing in flight. And of course, the Soyuz capsule has gone through all this testing already. So they just don't want to do testing in flight. Whereas the Dragon capsule, they still want to fly that by himself and do test flying by themselves. So that's the prime reason. But I'm sure that after, I don't know, 5 or 6 flights, they will do the same.
Right, then there's a question from Finn Bradley. I have a question regarding Starlink. I heard that the amount of satellites launched for this could result in stars not being visible anymore. What's the truth to this?
Yeah, the truth is that is truth. So so there is some astronomy observations that look at stars that have stripes in them, because these Starlink satellites, they fly through the image, and because there are so many, this occurs more often. It used to also occur, but there were not so many satellites in space. And now with Starlink, this year, I believe they now have 1,000 Starlink satellites in orbit. And with the total amount of satellites is about, I believe, 2,600. So the percentage of Starlink as the total population of satellites is becoming very big. And if they go to 42,000, I think astronomy doesn't really like that there are stripes in their images. But I must also say that the astronomers, they start to complain about this, but they should have also complained about all the light that comes from greenhouses. We have here in Westland, I cannot see a star from my garden in Delft.
No, but I think that's true, and especially if you see they're looking deeper into space right now, the astronomers.
Yeah.
So exposure time is longer, and the chance of a satellite passing by is increased, of course.
Yeah.
All right, there's a question from Arturo. What other Dutch products, think about Airbus defense and solar panels, do we expect to see in the future development for Orion or other spacecraft?
For specifically for Orion, there will be no other products, because the Netherlands, as we are part of the European Space Agency, there is every about 3 years there is this important meeting between all the nations of Europe that are in ESA, that contribute to ESA. They say, okay, this is the amount of money we put on the table, and the amount of money that Netherlands has put on the table for exploration basically is what the cost of those solar panels, and nothing extra. And also the whole exploration program, we used to have André Kuipers, of course, astronaut, the Dutch astronaut. But basically when the funny thing is, when André Kuipers landed, almost in the same time the Netherlands canceled their participation in the so-called ELLIPSE program. And ELLIPSE program was participation in ISS science. And so the Netherlands are not really at a government level interested in space from exploration. They're interested in they're extremely pragmatic. So Earth observation is important. The use of data from Earth observation instrumentation, that's important. And the solar panels, because there is Airbus Defence and Space Netherlands, they have a strong position, and yeah, the government wants to sustain that position. Yeah, for the rest, we have important participation Ariane 6, the new launcher for the follow-up launcher of Ariane 5. And we do Earth observation instrumentation. That's the core.
All right, then I think we go to the last question from Finn Bradley. Could you see the development of any space planes for commercial or scientific purposes in the foreseeable future?
Yeah, and then space planes being single stage to orbit. So you lift off from an airfield, and you go to space, and you are there, you do some stuff, and you go back. Is that the space plane?
I think.
Because a space plane can be a lot of things, but I think that idea, I don't see that work other than on paper. There's many companies that have already pushed for doing that, and you just see that the way to go to space now is to use a rocket like the SpaceX Falcon 9. They've also looked at different options of going into space, and I think they just found this is the way. There is no what I tend to say, what you see in the microelectronics, you see people in their garage building Apple, for example, or building Google, or building these Silicon Valley startups. I don't believe there is like a new idea that could put things in space other than just the chemical rockets. That's hazardous, explosions, that's big, that's powerful, you need the big range, you can't do that from your garage.
All right, then I think that's it for tonight. That's it, Yusuf.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right. You can just close the stream. Thank you all for watching, guys, and see you in the next stream.